Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for the freedom that you have given to us. As you've set us free from the bondages and the bonds of sin and death through the giving of your Son, Jesus Christ, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And so we come today with hearts of humility, just thanking you for your graciousness and your mercy. Lord, I ask that you would open up our hearts and open up our minds today, and as we begin our time of worship to you, that we would truly worship you as you said we need to worship you, and that is in spirit and in truth. And so as we open up our mouths, as we open up our hearts, Lord God, to sing forth your praise, may it truly be from hearts that are in love with you. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Light of the world, you stepped out into darkness. Open my eyes, let me see.
Yeah.
When the music fades, all is stripped away, and I simply come, longing just to bring something that's of worth, that will bless your heart. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made it. When it's all about you, it's all about you, Jesus. King of endless worth, no one could express how much you deserve. Though I'm weak and poor, all I have is yours, every single breath. I'll bring you more than a song, for a song in itself is not what you have required. You search much deeper within, through the way things appear, you're looking into my heart. Yeah. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, and it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made, when it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm coming back to the heart of worship, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. I'm sorry, Lord, for the thing I've made, 'cause it's all about you. It's all about you, Jesus. All about you. I'll bring you more than a song.
And so, Lord, we just want to give you our all. We give to you everything, Lord God. We give to you our heart, soul, mind, and strength. We are to love you with all of that, Lord God. May that truly be the prayer this morning. May that truly be our heart, is to give it all over to you because you are worthy of it, O Lord. Have your way in our lives here today. Have your way in what we are going to hear, that it may truly make a difference in our hearts and in our lives. That we will not be the same when we leave here today because we had that divine encounter with you. Because we know this for positive, Lord God, and that is, where two or three are gathered in your name, you are there in the midst, and you are here in our midst today. And so, Lord, I ask for that divine encounter with each and every person, whether it be here at the service, or, Lord, whether it be at home and watching over the internet. Lord, we give to you our all. Open up our ears, open up our mind, open up our hearts, Holy Spirit, to hear what you are speaking, not only into our lives, Lord God, but into your church. And this I ask in Jesus' name, amen. And so now would you get on up, meet and greet one another. We'll begin in just a moment. Well, welcome, church family. Thank you all for coming to Living Waters Fellowship, where God's healing waters flow. Our church is built on three pillars. The first one is evangelism, each one, reach one. The second one is on discipleship, building up the house of God within each person. And the third is mission, and that is to make a difference in our community and world for Christ. Now, we have a biblical maxim that we like to repeat every time we do come together. And so, as you see the words up on your screen, would you please repeat this with me? That we are mighty men and women of valor, because we are greater in the eyes of God than we are in our own eyes. And while our hearts may condemn us, God is greater than our hearts and knows what truly lies within. And so if you do have your cell phones with you, I do ask that you would just either turn them off or turn them to vibrate. So, you know, you don't need to talk to God through your cell phone. That's called prayer. So I just want to let you know that. If I could have our ushers come forward, please, as we take this opportunity to give our tithes and our offering. And as they are coming forward, would you please bow your heads with me? Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for giving us this time and opportunity to give unto you what you first gave unto us. Lord, you've given us this wonderful opportunity to give to you and to your work and to your kingdom. And so, Lord, as the giving goes forth today and as the giving has been going forth, Lord, I ask that you would allow the leaders here at Living Waters Fellowship to use these funds in a way that are right. Lord God, that we wouldn't waste even a single penny. And Lord, that they would be used to further your kingdom, not only here in Mesquite, but throughout the world. And this we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And so the bags are going forward. Just a couple of things for you that are watching online. There's a way that you can give as well. Our physical address is 211 West 1st South, Suite C. That's in Mesquite, Nevada, 89027. Or you can send it to P.O. Box 3294, again, Mesquite, Nevada, but 89127. Or you can go to our church's webpage, which is mesquitelivingwaters.com, and there's a place for you to be able to give that way as well. Just to let you know that as the bags are continuing going forth and everything else, we have a prayer team that after the service, we're going to have members of our prayer team up here. And so if you need any prayer whatsoever, please come on up and have them pray for you. The last thing you want to do is walk out the door and have a need not met or to seek the Lord God in a specific area. Just a couple of announcements here. Our Wednesday night Bible studies are at 6 o'clock in the evening. We have a time of worship, and then the women go into their study, which is the Song of Solomon, and the men, we do our study, which is The Measure of a Man by Gene Getz. Tonight is our Sunday night at the movie night. Come on out. It is a great movie. You'll find more about that in your bulletins, or you've had it in your emails or on Facebook as to what we're going to be looking at as a documentary, and it is a fabulous one. So I really encourage you guys to come on out and be a part of this. There's going to be free popcorn, free sodas, free goodies, just a time to get together as family, just in another way to worship the Lord. We do have Operation Christmas Child that is going on. It's Samaritan's Purse, and we're working with other churches within the valley, filling up what's called Christmas shoe boxes. And these are going to children around the world. This is a project that we do every year with the other churches. And the cost of sending one out totally with the shipping and everything else involved is $20. But in all honesty, whatever can be given will be accepted and will be greatly accepted. Hopefully we'll get out, it looks to me like hopefully around the 200 level of boxes, 200 or more boxes this year. Now, what's coming up, as you see in your bulletins, is what's called Reset Your Life. These are invitations that I'm asking. Please take a moment, think about who it is that you need to give an invitation to, and hand this to them. What this is that in November, on the 7th, 14th, and 21st, we're having special Sundays that we're inviting people to come on in. It's a great opportunity to invite people to come in. Everything is going to be set for it. We're going to have some food prior to the time together. We're going to have time together, then afterward, again, more food and fellowship that will be there. These messages are going to be special, and they're geared to speaking to our need to be part of the family of God. And the first one on November 7th is Resetting Your Life. And then November 14th is Reigniting Your Life. And then on the 21st, it's Refueling your life. And so these are basic messages, but are so needed. Even if you've been a Christian for quite some time, let me tell you something. This is something that you need to refresh yourself in what God has called for you to do and to be. And so that's what's going on here. I want to encourage you, tell your friends, tell them to come and see. Whatever it is, come and see, be a part. So with that, if you would bow your heads as we take this opportunity and pray in our service today. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you for giving us this time and opportunity to come into your presence, that we can hear your word, that we can hear your word in a way that's going to make a difference in our lives, because that's what your word does. Your word is true. Your word is transformative. And that is what I'm asking for today, that it would truly transform our lives in a way that we have not experienced before. So make that difference, Lord God, in our lives today. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, before we start, we always have another prayer, but it's always a part of a song. And so if you would you join in with me? Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. Melt me, mold me, fill me, use me. Spirit of the living God, fall afresh on me. And again, that is our prayer as well. Holy Spirit, that you would meet with each and every one of us, that you'd open up our eyes, open up our ears to hear what it is that you are speaking to your church, what you are speaking to our lives. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. And so today we're continuing. Actually, this is the last in our series on the forefathers of our faith as we start looking at a gentleman by the name of Enoch. There were three men that were at a funeral of a friend. And the pastor who was doing the service asked this question. He said, "What do you want your friends to say about you when you're laying in a casket?" Well, after the service was over, these three friends got together. And they started wondering about that which the pastor had asked. And so the first one said, "Well, I want my friends to say that I was a good man." The second one said, "Well, I want my friends to say that I was a giving man." Third one sat there for a second and said, "You know what? I want my friends to say, look, he's moving." Most of the time we have a problem when we come to, and trying to come to grips with what's going on around us and what is the most important thing. That is until we have a divine encounter with God. Only then do we realize that all the things that we're so worried about really aren't that important. They really don't matter all that much. Like when a person contracts cancer or they get a potentially fatal disease. Let me tell you something. All the things that bother them up to that point, they're not even thinking about any longer. It's not their main concern. Therefore, it all boils down to two things. Well, let me just say, it all boils down to just one thing as far as I'm concerned. And that is having that genuine, vibrant, and real relationship with Jesus Christ. Now, in God's Hall of Faith, found in Hebrews chapter 11, there's a man by the name of Enoch, whose walk with God was so pure, so vibrant, so honest, that God basically said, this is what it's all about. Now, let's look at what the Bible describes Enoch's life to be like. Now, it's only 13 words. But in these 13 words, we find a faith that is so powerful and so vibrant that God couldn't wait any longer. So what were these words? Well, it's found in Genesis chapter 5, verse 24. Look what he said. And Enoch walked with God, and he was not, for God took him. Now, in these early chapters in Genesis, especially in Genesis chapter 25, what we're given is Adam's family tree, the family tree of the human race, basically, to say it that way. And the Holy Spirit here chronicles all these men that followed Adam. And a lot of these guys lived a long time. Two of them lived over 950 years. But still, every one of them died, except for one, and that is Enoch. And while Enoch is mentioned less than a handful of times within the Bible, he was blessed with one of the most incredible distinctions and testimonies that has ever been given. And that is he walked with God. And suddenly, he goes missing. Why? Because God wanted to be with him, and God wanted him where he was at. And since we're in this series about the forefathers of our faith and looking at the type of faith that pleases God, Enoch's faith saw God wanting to be with him. Wow, that's some kind of faith. But what insight can we gain from these 13 words that can change our lives and to make our lives pleasing to God? Well, first, Enoch demonstrated his faith through his attitude. Notice what he says. Enoch walked with God. Now, you might want to take this opportunity and underline that word walked in your bulletin, because that's what it is. Now, there was a high school prom, and it was approaching, and one young man goes and asks his father if he could borrow his 1963 Corvette in order to take his date to the prom. That young man had some taste. Let me tell you something. But his dad said this: if you can improve one letter grade in each of your classes and get your hair cut, then I'll let you borrow the car. Well, a few weeks later, he brings back a report. He worked very hard, and he got all of his grades up, at least one letter. And so he shows it to his dad, and he asks for the keys to the car. And his dad said, "Sorry, son, but you didn't get your hair cut." Indignant, the boy replied, "Come on, Dad, even Jesus had long hair." His dad kind of smiled and said, "Yes, and Jesus walked everywhere he went." Now, that isn't the kind of walking that the Holy Spirit is speaking about. But the term walked, as used here, is synonymous with a person's way of life. In other words, how you walk is how you live your life. Enoch lived his life in such a way, it says, that he was pleasing to God. But what was it about his life that made him pleasing to God, that his faith was pleasing to God? What was it? What made it so special? Well, I think the clue can be found in what the Apostle Paul, in his letter to the Ephesian church, said. In Ephesians chapter 4, verses 1 and 2, he said this: "Walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love." What Paul is saying, if we want to live a life that is worthy of someone who has been chosen by God and who's come into this saving relationship with Jesus Christ, then we need to have the attitude of humility, gentleness, patience, acceptance, and love. Humility is an attitude that basically recognizes that we are, that recognizes our faults, recognizes those things about us that just aren't right. Gentleness is action associated with humility. Gentleness is the action that is associated with humility. Further, we are to patiently accept one another, as he said, bearing with one another in love. We also are to be forgiving one another as God has so forgiven us, and accepting one another as God has so accepted us. But I love the way the prophet Micah said it. He said, "He has shown you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you, that you do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God." And so Enoch demonstrated his faith first through attitude. Next, he did through association. Now, Enoch walked with God, which demonstrates his faith through his attitude. But more significant in this passage, in this phrase, was Enoch's association. And this is revealed in the second half of this phrase. Notice what he says: Enoch walked with God. Now, you might want to underline those words, "with God." The focus is on Enoch's deep, abiding relationship with God. Now, God could have chosen to define his relationship with us with any word, any way that he wanted to. But he used the word "Father" to describe his relationship with us. In other words, his relationship, he wanted to be as a father and children. In other words, he being our father and we his children. However, it's hard for some to understand that relationship because of their relationship with their earthly fathers. But to get the full idea of this, I love what Max Lucado describes this relationship as being, what this relationship is like. I love this. Listen, this is what he said. If God had a refrigerator, your picture would be on it. If God had a wallet, your photo would be in it. He said, whenever you need flowers, he sends them. And every spring and every sunrise comes. In other words, he gives you a sunrise every morning. He goes on to say, whenever you talk, he'll listen. He can live anywhere in the universe, but he chose to live in your heart. And then he ends with these words, face it, God is crazy about you. Is that beautiful? Now, concerning this relationship with God as Father, the Apostle Paul said it this way in Romans 8:15. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. That word Abba is the Aramaic word for our English word daddy. That is so neat. When we come to faith in Jesus Christ and we receive the Holy Spirit, God brings us into his own family and now allows us to call him not just Father, the formalized word, but now he says, you can call me Dad, Daddy, Papa. This word Abba is a word of complete intimacy. This is the type of relationship that God had with Enoch and that Enoch had with God. And so, first Enoch demonstrated his faith through his attitude, then through his association, and finally through his ascension. The last part of verse 24 says, for God took him. You might want to underline those two words, took him. Can you imagine how difficult it must have been to live during those pre-flood years before God's judgment was poured out? When gross immorality and godlessness were rampant and only a small remnant of God's people remained faithful to him? Oh, wait a second. I think we can. Because it's exactly the type of world that we're living in right now. So I guess Solomon was right when he said there's nothing new under the sun. Just like everyone else, Enoch was living under the shadow of God's judgment. And by what we are told in the book of Jude, Enoch conveyed this same message that the Lord was coming in judgment. Now, does this mean that God took Enoch to spare him from the coming judgment, from the coming flood? Well, it's a definite possibility. But the one thing that the Bible makes abundantly clear is that it was by faith that Enoch was taken up to heaven. And this is found in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 5, the first part of this verse. Look at it with me. By faith, Enoch was taken away so he did not see death. Enoch's ascension, or rapture, if you would, is a foreshadowing of the rapture that's going to take place, the rapture of the church before God's final judgment at the end of days or the end times. Our world today is so filled with depravity, dishonesty, and decadence that we are likewise living under the shadow of God's coming judgment. Now, this rapture is best described by the Apostle Paul in his letter to the Thessalonian church. In 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 and 17, look what it says. For the Lord God himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of an archangel, and with the trumpet of God. And the dead in Christ will rise first. Then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and thus we shall always be with the Lord. Now, whatever your take is concerning when the rapture is going to happen, the promise is this, is that the rapture will happen. It will take place. And all those who believe in Jesus Christ will be, as Paul says, caught up in the clouds to meet with Jesus, caught up into the air. Now, a lot of people out there that don't believe in the rapture, or that they have different views, they say that the word rapture is not found within the Bible. Well, unfortunately, that's not true. It is found in the Bible. It's that word caught up. That word caught up, Paul wrote the Greek word, which was harpazo. Harpazo means, if you would, a violent snatching away. Paul describes this when he said, in a moment, in a twinkling of an eye, faster than I can snap my finger, we're going to be gone. Now, when they translated the Greek text into Latin, this is where we get our word rapture from, because the Latin word is raptum. Raptum, which is where we get our word rapture. So the word is found in the Bible, just in the Latin translation. Enoch had faith in God. He walked with him, and then God took him to be with him. Enoch's life and faith demonstrates that it's possible to be faithful to God. It's possible for all of us to be faithful to God and then to experience the same thing that Enoch experienced. I want you to catch that. We can experience the exact same thing that Enoch himself experienced. Warren Wiersbe, in his commentary on Hebrews, said this: no matter how dark the day or how bad the news, we have the promise of our Lord's return to encourage us and to motivate us to be godly. One day sin will be judged, and God's people will be rewarded for their faithfulness. So we have every reason to be encouraged as we walk with God. Enoch therefore teaches us how we walk with God in a fallen world. And I see this in three ways as I look at what is talked about as far as Enoch is concerned. The first way is that it's a purposeful walk. Enoch had a mission and focus, and that was to please God. And in his daily walk, he would literally, and I believe this, he literally kept pace with God. As God was going slow, he'd go slow. God was going fast, he would go fast. He was always by God's side. He was always clinging to God's side. And then you know what happened? One day they're strolling along, and they just strolled right up to heaven. I love the way Amos said it. He said, can two walk together unless they be agreed? Enoch's life was one of purpose, and that purpose was to progress in his walk with God. Walking with purpose implies consistency. Enoch didn't just walk with God when times were good. Enoch walked with God when times were good and bad. He didn't walk with God for a while and then quit. He kept on walking with God. He went and continued to walk with God. He walked in unbroken fellowship with the Creator of the universe. And I hope you catch that. He walked with unbroken fellowship with the Lord God, Creator of the universe. Enoch went where God went. His walk drew him closer to heaven. His walk drew him closer to God, which means it distanced him further from the world. When we start walking closer to God, when we start walking in His ways, as that prayer is, as it on earth as it is in heaven, as we start walking closer, what happens is the world gets further and further away from us and our desire to live according to the ways of the world. Further, he didn't attempt to walk to heaven based upon his own dictates, based upon his own understanding of what God wanted. Rather, he chose to follow God's path, the path that God chose him to take. So his walk was a purposeful walk. Next, it was an intentional walk. We have to be intentional in whatever we do, especially when it comes with our time with God. We've got to be intentional. We have to be protective about our time with God, and that's because Satan is going to throw everything at us, including the kitchen sink. He's going to throw everything at us in order to get us away from that relationship with the Lord God. And while a daily meeting with God is one of the greatest necessities in this life and in our time, well, it's also one of the most difficult to maintain, it says. And I believe that because it is. That's why we need to be protective. So how do we go about doing it? It's by making a commitment. I really believe that word commitment is a new four-letter word within the church, because no one likes that word commitment. But we have to make a commitment and not allow discouragement to stop our daily walk with God. J.C. Ryle, an evangelical Anglican bishop, he said this: make it a part of every day's business to read and meditate on some portion of God's work. Yesterday's bread will not feed the laborer for tomorrow. Gather your manna fresh every morning. What Enoch teaches us is the importance of a daily private devotional life so we can keep our fervor for God, so we can stay on fire for God. And then last, it's an outspoken walk. We need to openly proclaim God's message to those around us. Enoch's message still rings as true today as it did when he spoke it. See, his message is that God is going to come to this earth in judgment. The book of Jude says it this way in verses 14 and 15. Enoch prophesied saying, "Behold, the Lord comes to execute judgment on all, to convict all who are ungodly among them of all their ungodly deeds, which they have committed in an ungodly way, and all the harsh things which ungodly sinners have spoken against him." Enoch was never controlled by this fallen world. That's why he could walk with God the way he did. That's why he could deliver God's message the way he did. You see, he was never controlled by anything else. You see, what Enoch did is he lifted up God. He never lifted up himself. He lifted up God, and he lifted up God's message. And so Enoch's faith was pleasing to God, which is what the writer of Hebrews goes on to say in the latter part of verse 5, 11 verse 5. The latter part says this. Look at it. For before he was taken, he had this testimony that he pleased God. And then he goes on to say in verse 6, without faith, it's impossible to please God. That which pleases God isn't all spiritual and mystical. It isn't when you feel the goosebumps on your arms. No. It's simply having an honest relationship with him. Enoch was pleasing to God because he had a close, intimate relationship with God. What I found interesting, and I hope you catch this. I love this when I saw this. And that is, this is exactly what the Lord said about his son Jesus. Exactly. To John the Baptist, the Father said this, "This is my beloved Son in whom I am well pleased." What was God pleased about? Jesus hadn't done anything up to this time. He hadn't taught any Bible lessons out there. He didn't do any miracles. He didn't heal anybody. He didn't do anything at this particular time. Yet God said, "I am well pleased." What God was pleased about was the relationship that he had. Notice what he said, "My beloved son." In other words, God was pleased in the relationship. There are those who say that they are Christians, but they don't really have a relationship with Jesus Christ. Let me just say that knowing about God is no substitute for a genuine, loving relationship with him. There are so many so-called Christians out there that know all they need to know about submission, but are unwilling to submit. They know all about honesty, but are far from being honest in their daily lives. They know all about what it is to forgive, but haven't helped the person who does them wrong. They say they believe in God's word, but don't follow it on a daily basis. And so what happens? They end up substituting knowledge for obedience and knowledge for a relationship. But when we understand this relationship, then we'll want to give everyone grace, because the grace that God has given to all of us, then we're going to want to lay down our lives in service to the Lord and to service to one another, because Jesus laid down his life and served us in every way possible. And then we'll want to forgive others because God has so forgiven us. This is not about religion. This is not about the Christian religion. It's about having a relationship with Jesus Christ, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And when we have that sort of relationship, let me give you this promise. It's a promise that you can keep. And that is, when the time comes and we're standing before the Lord, when we have this relationship with Jesus Christ, a loving relationship with him, then we'll hear these words, "Well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord." That is yours to take with you. There will come a time when either we are going to leave this earthly body through death. He says to be absent from the body, to be present with the Lord. Or those that are alive and remaining shall be caught up in the air to be with him forever. Whichever way, we are all going to meet with God. And I don't know about you, but I want to hear, well done, good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Will you please bow your heads with me as we look to the Lord as we end our time together. Heavenly Father, I want to thank you so much for meeting with us here today. Holy Spirit, I ask that you would speak these words deep into our hearts. Lord, that we would truly have that faith. Because we that faith that brings us into that relationship with you. Knowing this, as that is what pleases you the most, and that is that relationship. Where we are sons and daughters of the Most High God. We're your sons and daughters. And you then are our Father. You then are our Daddy, our Papa. What a beautiful relationship. Maybe you are here, or you're listening to this online, and you don't have that relationship. It doesn't matter how long you've come to know the Lord, or how long you've come to church, I should say. Been a part of this church or any church or whatever it is. Until you come into that saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, asking Jesus Christ to be your Savior and Lord, then that relationship is just knowledge. It isn't a reality. And so this morning, if you've not known the reality of that relationship, then right now, ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, to be your Savior and Lord. Ask him to forgive you of your sins, to cleanse you from all unrighteousness. And his promise is that exactly what he will do. That is exactly what he will do for you. And God doesn't lie. That's a promise. And know this, that all the old of the past, all the junk of your past will be done away with. And everything for you will be brand new. And yet there's just one more thing. And that is, Jesus says, if we confess him before others, he'll confess us before the Father. But if we deny him, then he'll deny us. So today, if that was your prayer, if that is your desire to come into that saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, to have him be Savior and Lord of your life, where God is our Father and we are his children, then right now just say yes. If you're here, and just raise your hand and say, yeah, that's me. That's your acknowledgement. Yeah, that's me. I want to accept Jesus Christ as my Savior and Lord. And even at home, raise your hand. It's not about who sees here. It's about whether God sees. And so, Lord, I thank you for the new life and the renewed life that has been here today. And this I ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Count the times I've called your name some broken night, and you showed up and patched me up like you do every time. I get amnesia, I forget that you keep coming around. Yeah, ain't no way you ever let me down. Good God Almighty, I hope you find me praising your name. You say your love goes on forever, that your mercy never stops. So why would I assume you'll be the morning. I know you're gonna be there every day. So what on earth could make me be afraid? Good God Almighty, I hope you'll find me praising your name no matter what comes. Cause I know where I'd be without your mercy. So I keep praising your name at the top of my lungs. Tell me, is he good? Tell me, is he God?
He's God.
He is good God Almighty.
Praise him in the morning, praise him in the noontime, praise him when the sun goes down. Love him in the morning, love him in the noontime, love him when the sun goes down.
Good God Almighty.
Thank you, Lord God. Thank you, Lord God, for all that you are doing. Thank you, Lord God, that you have met with us here today. And so, Lord, I ask that you would move in a mighty, mighty way in here. Help us, Lord. Be with us for the rest of this day as we look to you. To you, Lord Jesus, the author and the perfecter, the author and the finisher of our faith. And so go before us now. And this we ask in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen. 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 Listen, if you have any prayers, if you need prayer for anything, we have our prayer team up here. Please come on forward and let them pray for you. God bless. Have a great rest of your day. See ya.